Okay, again, welcome everybody to this webinar. I can see that we have now reached 100 participants, 101. So people are still slowly logging on. But anyhow, I will start. And first of all, I would like to thank our speaker, Despina Moschus from Necker in Paris, of course, who will give us an overview today about primary HLH at all ages, which is certainly a challenging disease and very interesting too, with multiple recent developments in diagnostics, but also in therapy and improving outcomes. So I'm very much looking forward to your presentation, Despina, and I would give my great thanks from the whole ESID and ERN RITA community to you for agreeing to give this webinar. And the screen is yours now. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Michael, for this kind introduction and for having me here today. It's for sure a complicated disease, and more and more things go further with also the help of sophisticated genetics. We realize that it's a very, very broad phenotype, this disease, and some difficulties also for diagnostics. So I will start. I have nothing to disclose. And so you all know the clinical features of primary HLH, which are not very specific. So it starts with fever, splenomegaly, a patient in a bad general condition. Sometimes there's rash, hemorrhages, edema, and there will be, in some cases, neurological alterations, which can go until very difficult states and convulsions and organ dysfunctions. You all know the biological features that complete the picture, which are also not very specific. So it can go to pancytopenia, fibrinopenia, low natrium, elevated liver enzymes, high triglycerides, and high ferritin. And very soon the patient will be very ill in some cases. And this is really the challenge, because you have a tremendous variability from very slight signs in some patients. And then if it goes wrong in a very short time, you may be in a fatal condition. So it's a real challenge to be in time, to have the right diagnosis and to start the right treatment, what we will see. We now know that primary HLH is a primary T-cell immunodeficiency, which you see here, defects in cytotoxic T-cells. And if we now think about the pathophysiological background, you see here on the top the situation in a normal individual, where upon a viral infection, cytotoxic CD8 T-cells will get activated, and they have the mission to eliminate infected cells. And as soon as the virus is cleared, the immune response will calm down and some memory T cells will persist. In an individual with HLH, upon a viral infection, but as we will see, sometimes without any infectious trigger, CD8 positive T cells will be massively activated. They are not able to accomplish their mission, and they can't kill infected cells. They will more and more secrete interferon gamma, which is really a key molecule in this pathophysiology, and thereby activate macrophages, which in turn will also secrete pro-inflammatory substances like IL-6, TNF, and IL-18. And all this is a kind of vicious circle where T cells, CD8 T cells and macrophages will get more and more activated, and they will infiltrate massively the organs of the patient. And this gives rise ultimately to all the clinical and biological features of HLH. It's worth to note that in newborns, there is normally no infectious triggers in the primary HLH forms. You see here beautifully the work of Stefan Ehl and his colleagues, and we have the same observation in our cohort in Paris, that many patients have been analyzed, some here in the upper part, patients who died during pregnancy, but some patients at birth or very soon after birth have been discovered with genetically proven HLH and virtually no infectious trigger. The only virus you really need to rule out, which can mimic primary HLH in the newborn, is herpes virus, neonatal herpes virus. And these are patients who may not have any genetic background and can present like HLH, but usually in newborns, there is no infectious trigger, which shows somehow that these severe neonatal forms have a problem in T-cell homeostasis, and so far no infectious underlying disease is noticed. So as I told you that all the symptoms of HLH are caused by this massive expansion of inflammatory and activated T-cells, and so the high concentrations of inflammatory substances give rise to the picture. The elevated IL-1 and IL-6 causes the fever. Elevated TNF-alpha and interferon-gamma leads to pancytopenia. And as TNF-alpha inhibits lipoprotein lipase, you may have elevated triglycerides, and the activated macrophages lead to the high levels of ferritin and the hyperfibrinolysis with low levels of fibrinogen. And one hallmark are the activated T-cells, and so the soluble IL-2 receptor, also called CD25, is a marker for this activation. And then, as I told you, the organs will be infiltrated by these activated lymphocytes and histiocytes. And you will see it if you would do biopsies, like here in a liver biopsy, you see massively activated cells and TNF-alpha, IL-6, interferon-gamma, and also CD8 T-cells in the tissue. And so in a very pragmatic way, you need to really go fast to diagnosis in order to pick up the patient and give him the right treatment before the activation will go further and, create great problems on the clinical side. So the Histiocyte Society has established criteria, which are fever, splenomegaly, cytopenia in at least two lineages, hypertriglyceridemia or hypofibrinogenemia, hemophagocytosis in tissue like bone marrow or if you do a biopsy. And for older patients, really, you have to pay attention that there are no signs of malignancy or rheumatic diseases which can mimic secondary HLH. So if you have a laboratory that can test functional points, you will notice that there are low or absent natural killer cell activity, but these tests, even if they are very helpful, they are not available everywhere and have their limitations. I will speak about this later. You have the high ferritin and the markers of T-cell activation with the CD25, the soluble IL-2 receptor. And if you have 5 out of 8 criteria, then you can reasonably go ahead with treatment without waiting further for genetic confirmation, as in some patients, really time is a very important factor in order to be efficient with the treatment and cure the patient in the end. The pathophysiology of primary HLH is resumed in this cartoon. So you have the cytotoxic T cell, which will go to meet the target cell and form the immunological synapse. and you have lytic granules which contain perforin granzyme, which need to migrate to this zone of contact, so to this immunological synapse. And then the lytic granules will secrete the substances in this area and lead to the apoptosis of the target cell. And this mechanism, which is a defect in primary HLH. And so there are different genetic forms, but they all affect the same mechanism. And if you have here, you imagine on the upper part, the cytotoxic T cell, on the lower part, the antigen presenting cell with the immune synapse, you need to migrate these granules to the area of the immune synapse. And if you have no perforin or a problem in migrating, this has the same effect in order to abolish the cytotoxicity. And so you see that there are different genetic forms. It starts with the type 2 of HLH, because initially there was a paper out thinking that the type 1 had been discovered, but no gene was later found in this homozygous area of chromosome 9 that had been described. So for the moment, there is no type 1. So it starts counting with type 2, and you have perforin, MUNC 13-4, Syntaxin 11, and MUNC 18-2 for the type 2, 3, and 4, and 5. I just want to stress very few things on the different genetic forms. I would like to say that perforin is for sure a gene that helps us a lot to have a quick diagnosis, because if the protein is not expressed, you will be able to see it in the immune phenotype immediately. And so this is really helpful for the forms with perforin deficiencies. And you have also for this gene a kind of genotype-phenotype correlation, because the complete absence of perforin will lead to very early onset of HLH at birth or in the first few months, you see from birth to 3 months, whereas the patients with missense mutation who have a complete loss of activity will also develop HLH very soon in life. But there are patients with missense mutations retaining partial activity who will really develop HLH quite late in life, and there you may see also young adults with genetic determined primary HLH who will develop the full-blown activation syndrome only later. So this is something that you really need to pay attention to. And another point that I wanted to raise is that for the MUNC 18-2 patients, there is another feature. It's not only an immunological problem, but you see here in red, MUNC 18-2, which is present in the epithelial cells of the gut. And this means that complete absence of MUNC 18-2 may lead to enteropathy. And this enteropathy will not respond to bone marrow transplantation, as it's not an immunological determined gut disease, but really a structural problem in the epithelium cells. And you need to know this in order to get the best care for your patients, because for sure, sometimes after bone marrow transplantation, if you have persisting diarrhea, you may look for a lot of other reasons like GVHD or viral infections. And unfortunately, in some of these patients, it's a really persisting problem due to anatomological abnormalities, as you see here. In an MUNC18.2 patient, you see that the apical membrane is clearly not normal. And so this is a form, particular form. So I want to add the X-linked forms, which go also along with HLH. So that's the famous Portillo syndrome for the discoverer of this form. And there are two genes that are implicated in this X-linked lymphoproliferation. It's SAP, XLP type 1, or XIAP, and they both have pretty the same manifestations with some exceptions. So they will develop HLH often related to primo infection with EBV, as you see here. They may have hypogammaglobulinemia even before onset of HLH, and it's important to know that patients with a deficiency in SAP will develop at about 30% lymphoma. And if you compare this to patients who are mutated in XIAP, there you have virtually no patients who develop lymphoma, but you may see immune dysregulation in the gut with colitis. And this is something that may regress after successful bone marrow transplantation because it's immunological process, even if reconstitution of the gut function will take quite a lot of time after transplantation. I want to continue to just to say that EBV, which is a trigger very important for the two XLP1 and 2 conditions, is something you need to look carefully, pay carefully attention to, because what I'm not going to treat today, but which is really important to know that it exists, sometimes EBV will not replicate in B cells, but in T cells, and then we are in a situation that we call chronic active or CA EBV, which may also have very much of the features of primary HLH, but it is not primary HLH and the treatment is really not the same. So this is something that I'm not going to speak at all about today, but you need to know that this exists. I want to just to have some also some cases in this presentation. So this is a 10-year-old boy with no significant personal or family history. So he starts to get ill in the end of January with some cytopenia. You see the platelets at 54,000, anemia and fever. They do a bone marrow, which is normal, and they start to treat him with some antibiotics. He will develop hepatosplenomegaly and have some atypical scan results with a kind of pneumopathy. And you see that then things deteriorate, platelets get lower, and anemia is still present. The patient will be somnolent and has a difficult neurological condition. Some other results, ferritin not too high, triglycerides at 3, an abnormal lumbar puncture, excuse me, I didn't change it to English, but there were lymphocytes in the puncture and high proteins, and the patient gets seizures and ends up in the intensive care unit, and you have this really very abnormal brain MRI 3 weeks after onset, which large areas of hyper signals, and this is in favor of intracerebral HLH. This patient has another particularity because he has quite silvery hair, and if you ask Google silvery hair and seizures, the response is very, very fast. You find the Griscelli syndrome, which I will talk about. If you are French, you need to be a bit, little bit more, how to say, you need to wait a bit more, because if you ask Google cheveux argentés convulsion, it's more that fashion comes out. But if you then have a new keyword like disease, you end up also to find these partial albinisms which go along with HLH. And so there are some diseases I really want to speak about. It's the Griscelli syndrome, the Shigeaki-Gashi syndrome, but also the Hermansky-Pudlak syndrome type 2. And you see the the genes that are known to cause this syndrome right here. The diagnosis is really easy, because you have the abnormal hair with abnormal pigmentations, and in the Shigeaki-Gashi syndrome you may have also large granules. And so you need to think about these diseases which are for least, and so Shigeaki-Gashi and Griscelli syndrome, they affect the same cascade of what I showed you before. And so another point not to forget is this isolated, sometimes really isolated involvement of the CNS. And this is not only for perforin, as it's shown here, where you have even in a brain biopsy, if you do this, which is really not necessary nowadays, you see the activated T cells around the vessels. And this has been described by the group of Genevieve de Saint-Basile since a long time. And more patients are found, not only perforin, but also other of the HLH genes that can give rise to a kind of isolated brain HLH. And this is easy to find for perforin, as I told you, as you can find it in the FACS analysis. So to sum up what I told you, just to give you the clinical picture, you may have a pre or neonatal onset of HLH, and there you have already especially the perforin 9 mutations or MUNC 13-4 patients. More the patients have hypomorphic mutations, later they will declare HLH and maybe not very fulminant at onset. And more infectious trigger will be important to trigger this HLH. And some keywords, the colitis in among 18-2 null mutation patients, and also in XIAP patients, where EBV is again a very important keyword. Sub-XLP, you need to think of the lymphomas. Syntaxin 11 is not very, no characteristics, and also not very frequent. Albinism really needs to catch your attention, and these isolated neurological forms are very, very difficult because sometimes you don't have at all the clinical picture of splenomegaly or the biological features. So really don't forget that this may be a late onset of primary HLH with a neurological problem. And so another atypical form, and we, I think as time goes by, we will be more and more in these cases. So this is an 11-year-old girl without any medical history. She starts her medical career being admitted in the ICU for IRDS, and you see her very impressive scan results. Some abnormal results, a bit of anemia, platelets at 130, not so bad, fibrinogen normal, triglycerides ferritin was not done, lymphopenia at this time, and so she has a lymphohistiocytic infiltrate in the different tissues that have been evaluated, and so the conclusion was that it is an interstitial pneumonitis on the ground of a primary immunodeficiency, and she got high-dose steroids. She relapses. Here again, you have some more features of HLH maybe. She develops a splenomegaly. Platelets are low, fibrinogen low, triglycerides high. And again, this time even a lung biopsy that is done and there is a diffuse interstitial lymphocytic pneumonitis. And so again, high dose of steroids and things develop. She has some T cells that are activated. Degranulation assay is done, is said normal. Perforin has been assessed, has been found expressed normally. And so the question is, can we from this really say that primary HLH is ruled out? I think what you need to take home is that you need to go to genetics, which will be seen in the next slide. So again, the patient relapsed and she had an NGS of autoimmunity. Unfortunately, there was nothing found. And then unfortunately, she develops brain involvement. This is 19 months from onset and still not a lot of HLH criteria in her workup. Ferritin is really normal. Platelets are high. But again, there is cytology of the CSF with mixed lymphohistiocytic cellularity. And the genetics finds a compound heterozygous mutation in MUNC 13-4. And so this is really a patient where you can see the difficulties in diagnosing. So if you see over the different episodes, you never have really all the criteria for HLH together. As I told you, normally you wait for 5 out of 8 criteria. And what I really want to tell you is that you need to go to genetics if you have the slightest suspicion of HLH. And also in this patient, despite the fact that in the end it will be a MUNC 13-4 patient, the degranulation had been found normal. This shows the limits of this functional tests. And so this for this case, I thank Martin Castel, who had given me the some of these slides. And this was done by, for sure, by Capucine Picard and Geneviève de Saint-Basile, very implicated, and Benedict Neven and the other clinicians. A patient has been followed initially in Nancy. And so I want to finish just to show you that there are new players. There's NLRC4, which can get some criteria of HLH in a very autoinflammatory context. And you see that here, IL-18 is a very important mediator of this activation process. And so there has been also a paper showing that these patients can be successfully treated with IL-18 inhibition. And so I will end by having some words on treatment. And so you know that it was a very difficult disease to treat, with in the beginning really almost all patients who died. And it's then since the 80s that the treatment has been put forward by the with a combined chemotherapy with VP16 and steroids in order to calm down the activation. Once this is achieved, you need to go forward to bone marrow transplantation. For sure, I told you that it's not an oncological disease, but an immunodeficiency. So nowadays, you would not like to use VP16 because it's quite toxic. You may have aplasia, infectious complications, and it's not necessary to do this kind of treatment nowadays. But there are still quite a lot of countries where there is no other alternative. for the newer drugs that I'm going to speak about in a second. So this remains a valuable treatment, but then you need also to go to bone marrow transplantation in order to cure the patients. And we have now developed immunotherapy. I showed you that activated T cells are at the heart of the pathophysiological mechanisms. So ATG has been used in our unit in a first and second line treatment with good results. And we now went further to use alemtuzumab, which is Campath, which kills T cells efficiently in vivo, but also NKDC and B cells. And this treatment had been used in a large number of patients. We had done a pilot study with 24 consecutive patients, very ill patients, 6 patients with neonatal onset, half of them requiring intensive care, and also with CNS involvement at onset. There were some more patients treated outside the trial that had been done furthermore. So I'm a bit, because of the 5 minutes that we waited in the beginning, I'm a bit running out of time. So I'm just showing you that this first pilot study was not very determined about the dose. And this is why the slide is a bit busy, because we did not really know how much we should need. But the important thing to show you is that most of the patients, 25 out of 27 patients, and you saw that they were quite ill at onset, could go to transplantation and in very good remission, because 92% had been in complete remission at the time of conditioning and 8 in partial remission. And so we then had a prospective study, and we did the same inclusion criteria as the HLH criteria. We included also suspected primary HLH with predominant neurological involvement, also without genetics, and also if less than 5 out of 8 criteria were fulfilled at inclusion. And in the end, we had so this is the team that we used, sorry. So we did a first course of 0.5 milligram kilo alemtuzumab on day 1, followed by 1 milligram kilo on day 2 and 3 in association with methylprednisolone and cyclosporin A. We had weekly assessment, additional courses according to the protocol that you can request if you wish. I will send it to you. And we saw that pathological CSF often normalized at day 14 without intrathecal methotrexate, showing that having a good control of the HLH will have a good impact on these neurological forms. And so we included 29 patients. 3 patients in the end were not confirmed on genetical on the genetical side. So you see the other genetics, that is quite what I told you before. And so we could analyze 25 patients, and from these 25 patients, we have a very good response. We have 96% of response, 68% of partial complete remission, and 28% of partial remission at day 28. And this was even better at the time when patients went to conditioning. And so we had good results and were very pleased on it. And I think we lost 2 patients in the COMPASS phase. One patient who had very important neurological involvement at onset, and he was beyond cure because he had already neurological sequelae. And we had one patient who died at 30 hours after inclusion. And from the other patients, we could bring them all to transplantation, 23 out of these 25 patients. And you see that, again, even if we didn't have perfect donors, 9 out of 23 patients were haplodonors. We had a good survival after transplantation, 87% survival after transplantation. That makes that we had an overall survival for this cohort of 80%. And we were even able to bring a patient who had been born with full-blown HLH at 30 weeks of gestation, and we could bring this patient to haplotransplant. So I will stop here in order to let time for discussion. I will thank the head of department, Stefan Blanche, Alain Fischer, et Benedict Neven, and the multiple colleagues present and past of our unit. Capucine Picard, for sure, which is very important for diagnosis, and Geneviève de Saint-Basile for lymphohistiocytosis and all her contribution for the field. Sylvain Latour, which is more on the XIAP, SAP and EBV-related activation, which is his field of research, and all the colleagues who participated in the prospective trial, and for sure for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Despina. Excellent overview and rundown of all the facets of this fascinating disease. I missed to announce that you could ask questions via the question tab in your app during the talk. Already some people were clever enough to do that. And we also had two patients submitted to us from before, even before the webinar. So I will try to start with that. If I can make my app smaller. No, I can't. There we go.
Michael, I don't know how to get out of the screen model to see the questions, maybe.
You can see the questions in the tab on the left-hand side. Otherwise, I will read them to you anyhow. So the first question that came in before the webinar is actually very interesting because it deals with a very novel disease. The question comes from Genoa and asks, in a patient with Hermansky-Pudlak syndrome type 11, whether there were any functional lab tests that you could recommend to characterize the risk of HLA or to diagnose HLH in this patient. I think this question also relates to the questions whether there are any good clinical tests to diagnose HLH in other patients where the genetic etiology is either unknown or is some novel disease.
So the type 11 has been very recently described of Hermansky-Pudlak. I'm not aware of the complete insights on pathophysiology, but as I showed you, and I really want to insist on it, sometimes even well-defined primary HLH genes like MUNC13-4 or some of these genes will have normal degranulation assays in the lab. And this does not really rule out that they are pathological. So I think you need to try to do as much as you can. And if you find a clear abnormal function, this might help you to decide to go maybe even to preemptive transplantation. But if you don't find an abnormal test, I would not be really affirmative that your patient will not later on have a kind of HLH on another ground. So it's difficult. I don't think that you that normal tests are completely ruling out that there may be a kind of activation predisposition for this patient. So this is only clinical and long-term follow-up for these patients that can help you, unfortunately.
Thank you. I think this was also underlined by the patient you presented with NLRC4, that actually the lab testing can be helpful only so far, and that especially these days, genetic testing and whole exome sequencing is really the way to go for patients, especially for pediatric patients, but also for adult patients with suspected HLH. Do you agree?
I completely agree, and I feel that this will open our view of primary HLH, because if you remember old times where you had to really argue hard to have one gene sequenced, that means that only typical cases had access to genome genetic tests. And nowadays that we have this broad approach and that we can have panels and rule out at once a large number of disease-causing genes, I feel that we will have a lot of surprises with atypical adult late onset, not full-blown HLH patients, that we will find that they will be mutated in these genes. And then it's a difficult question what to do with these patients, and for sure if they have recurrent HLH episodes, then even older patients may need transplantation, I feel.
Yeah, thanks. And the second question is also important and probably quick to answer. What's the role for ruxolitinib in pediatric HLH, and how would you dose it?
That's a very good question. So I feel that there is a role for ruxolitinib because, as you saw, interferon gamma is a key molecule, and especially also the responses to interferon gamma that will be induced in this patient. And so JAK inhibitors can be very useful to control HLH. There are some rare case reports. We are about to launch a prospective trial, but we still did not really start it or use it. And so for the dosing, I would go rather to high doses. And maybe in the very small patients, you could even consider to give it three times a day and not only twice a day, which is enough for older patients. And then I would dose it and check the response. But so far, I can't give you a clear evidence-based dosing right now, but I feel this is a very useful molecule, and hopefully we will have response to these questions in our upcoming prospective trial.
Yes, thank you. We're very much looking forward to that. One question came in from Amalia Risky, which I think is very important for daily management of these patients. How often do you find hematophagocytosis in bone marrow aspiration? And this also implies the question, if other criteria are already fulfilled, do we really need to perform the bone marrow aspirate in these patients?
So for these neonates, for instance, we almost, also if the patient comes directly to Paris and we have the full-blown HLH, we will not do bone marrow, actually. Some of our newborn patients who've been referred to us from other, especially hemato-oncological units, they often have it in the workup. I think that the bone marrow exploration is important for older patients and for patients who have not the complete criteria, who may have some odd findings that you are not so sure if it's not a rheumatological or a malignancy. And then you really need to go to bone marrow. You need to do a clonality in the bone marrow in order to rule out some hemopathy, which may present like primary HLH. But if you have a small patient with the typical presentation, we do not do regularly this assay.
Yeah, thank you. Very interesting question and very obvious question. Have you already used the interferon gamma monoclonal antibody, and what has been your experience? We know it's not licensed in Europe, but in the United States. Yeah.
It's not licensed in Europe because there are some concerns on the efficacy. So we did not use it, as we did not take part in the trial. If you go to the New England Journal paper that has been come out last year, you see that from the 34 treated patients, only 7 patients had been primary HLH patients at first line treatment. The other 27 patients had been treated second line with this drug. And I'm a bit concerned on efficacy, because if you look carefully into the 7 patients, which is a small number, I agree, but these 7 patients who had had imapalumab in a first line approach, they did not respond well. Actually, 4 out of these 7 patients died, and 2 out of the 7 patients received VP16 in a second line treatment. So that I'm concerned not to be able to tell anything consistent on the efficacy of this drug in first line treatment. Maybe not enough to block only interferon gamma.
Yeah, thank you. For this matter, I would also like to refer people to the recent comment. I think you were the last author published in Pediatric Blood and Cancer. I think it's Stefan Ehl et al. Very recommended. And along these lines also, I mean, you mentioned that IL-1, TNF-alpha, interferon gamma, and IL-6 are the main cytokine players in pathogenesis of HLH. So what's your thought on inhibiting all those pathways? I mean, we have approved drugs against IL-1, IL-6, and TNF-alpha. And possibly in the future, interferon gamma.
Yeah, I mean, it's always the question if blocking one alone will be enough, as there are other cascades around. So in the primary full-blown HLH patients, I fear that this may not be enough to be really efficient.
Yeah. Do you think there's another question from the Q&A section here? Do you think CD107A expression is needed for workup when you are not quite sure about HLA diagnosis, and could it be abnormal in secondary HLL as well?
Yeah, I mean, we come again to the field that today. I think that besides all what you can do in diagnostic labs, which is surely very important to do, if you have doubts, you need to go to panel sequencing. And even what we think may be secondary HLH will end up eventually to be primary hypomorphic forms of genetics. And so I think it's difficult to specifically answer this question with regard to the value of this assay in secondary HLH. And I really think that the most important thing will be genetics.
Yeah, there's another question along those lines. How you interpret normal degranulation assays in patients with genetically proven degranulation defects. Is this just the test is not good enough, or is there a biological explanation behind this?
I would think that probably the test may not be sensitive enough to show the real life situation. And because, I mean, if you think about the cascade that I showed you with the pathophysiological background, you feel that the impact of, for instance, MUNC13.4 mutations must abolish somehow the complete traffic of the granules to the destination. And so I'm a bit... I don't think that the tests are really sensitive enough to show the whole picture, but it's true. It's sometimes a bit surprising. And the patient I showed you that we treated that has been diagnosed at birth, 30 weeks of gestation, and for this patient we had a normal degranulation assay. We were a bit nervous, but then genetics came and it was MUNC 13-4, which was a clear important impact of the pathogenic mutation. So
yeah, I couldn't agree more. I have one more very interesting practical question. So in patients with high cell count in the liquor, do yes. you always give intrathecal MTX even though there is no sign of neurological disease?
No. What we do is that, so we are very attentive to this, very careful to evaluate this issue. If we have a patient who is clearly clinically in a bad condition, we may consider to inject intrathecal MTX. But for the other patients, where we have a patient who has just some abnormal liquor analysis at onset, we wait until day 14, and then we decide what to do if there is still some abnormal cells, some activated lymphocytes in the lumbar puncture. But often we see that this normalizes completely only with the general control due to CAMPAS. So especially in the very young patient, MTX intrathecally might be quite toxic because you can sometimes even see aplasia after this injection. So really for the very young patients, we don't do it at all. For older patients with predominant neurological onset, you may need eventually, I say you may need, but you may be forced to inject, even if actually no one ever has done a prospective study to clearly define the role of intrathecal MTX. So,
yeah. And you always need to keep in mind that these patients are also, all of them, receiving high dose steroids, which will yeah. also have an effect on the CNS. Disease. One other practical questions. Do you consider that C3 and C4 serum levels or complement serum levels can help to differentiate in some way between primary and secondary HLH?
Well, I never thought about this question, and we do not regularly dose these levels. So I'm not sure that I can really give a helpful answer.
I have the same issue. I was hoping you could give us an answer. So let's see. There is another very specific question from Sandra Amann. The FHL3 patient you showed, was the NK cell degranulation tested as well? Because normal or defective NK cell degranulation is a bit more sensitive than activated T cell degranulation.
Yeah, in our lab, they don't do the NK cells, but I completely agree that these tests may be more specific. But then it's also the problem that you don't have easily access to all these fancy tests.
Yeah, I will probably close with a more speculative question, but very interesting nevertheless. Given the key role of interferon gamma in HLH, are primary immunodeficiency diseases with interferon gamma production defects protected from secondary HLH?
Yes and no. Maybe because interferon gamma is a central player, but it's not everything, and there are a lot of other pro-inflammatory substances that are secreted by the macrophage system, and so I'm not sure that this only interferon gamma driven. So I guess that there could be still some other mechanisms driving the activation.
Thank you. I think time is up now for us to close, and we had well over 100 participants in this webinar, and I'm sure they all agree that this was excellent. Thank you very much, Despina, for giving such a great talk, and I think we can only stress the messages that you left here about this fascinating disease, and I'm very happy to announce that this will also be available as a recording via the ERN RITA and the ESID websites. You will be linked to YouTube, where you can rewatch the seminar if you want, or show it to other people who didn't make it today for other reasons. I can only also announce that there will be a next webinar on PID from this channel relatively soon. I don't have the exact date, but you will be informed via the usual channels. So on behalf of my colleagues at ESID and of my colleagues at ERN RITA, again, let me thank you, Despina, for giving this great webinar, and have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you for your interest. Nice weekend to everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.